Hi, this is Pastor Garrett here at Newark Presbyterian Church. Glad you could join us today as we continue to go through the Ten Commandments. So we're glad that you could be a part of this. And as we move into this new future where people are getting vaccinated, that the quarantines are lifting, we'll have more information about how we plan to reopen. So today, later in the service, Mike Marzano will be sharing about plans for our church and how we are going to reopen. So that is great news for all of us. But in the meantime, we hope that as you continue to watch, we're so glad you could be here, that you've been faithful through this whole long journey with us together. Again, my thanks to the AV team who is here every single time to help record and put this together so that you can watch this. So may God bless you as we move through today and continue to look at the Ten Commandments.
Good morning. I'm Mike Marzano, one of your trusted trustees, and this is probably the first time that I've been up here to talk to you that it's not about money. But I've got some good news. First Presbyterian Church of Newark is going to start in-person services on May 16th, 9:30 in the morning. So we're trying to give you advance notice that you can all be here. Things will be a little bit different when you come, but you'll get used to that. Everyone will still be required to wear a mask. It's always a challenge, but understand that the people up here don't need to wear a mask. They're far enough back that they don't have to be able to do that. We're trying to comply with all these different regulations that we have. We'll screen everyone as they come into the church. We'll also be seated in a social distance pattern across the different pews. So you may not be able to sit in your old seat where you always sat before, but we'll try to get you close. We can sing, but we still have to keep our masks on when we sing. We're sorry at this time there's no children's program, but we're trying to get the services started and everything going before we start adding in other parts of our regular services. After the service, we'll still be serving some coffee. The rules allow us to be able to serve coffee, and we can socialize out on the patio, outdoors, so that you can see all the friends you haven't seen other than on a Zoom screen for quite a while. So everyone, as we look at the differences, we'll try and help you get acquainted with it. We'll be sending out our reopening plan so that you can look at that and know what to expect when you walk in the door. We know that some of you won't be able to join us for this in-person service, and we don't want you to feel left out. Our AV crew has been working hard to install new equipment so that we can live stream the service to you. So that'll be a continued thing that we're going to continue live streaming. And if you look a little, if it looks a little different, you know, bear with us. Things are going to be a little changed. Garrett will be up here. He doesn't get take one, take two, take three. And the bloopers, you don't have to wait for the end. The bloopers will be throughout the entire service. We ask that everyone be patient. It's a lot of work for us to change as we try to meet all these requirements and have all the details so that we can actually meet in person and be able to do the live streaming. And so that you know, all of the live streaming and the service will still be on our same YouTube channel so that you don't have to figure out some new place to find us. So this is your notice. To be prepared for May 16th, 9:30 in the morning. If you need to get a haircut, you need to pull some clothes out of the closet, whatever it's going to take, be prepared. Just remember, you can come as you are, and you will be loved. We look forward to seeing you May 16th at 9:30.
Hello, everyone. Before we pray, let's listen to Psalm 8, one of my favorites. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds and animals of the wild, the birds in the sky and the fish in the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Let's pray. Dear God, words are not enough to express our praise to you. The words we speak, the tunes we sing, the thoughts we think, the emotions we feel, may these all be pleasing to you. For in spite of the inadequacy of our words, this worship is addressed to you. Make it complete, whole, and full to overflowing, O great and awesome God. Heavenly Father, thank you for our church family that includes everyone who's watching this service. Thank you for all those who make this service possible, including the pastor, the church staff, and the many volunteers. We thank you for protecting us and our loved ones and neighbors as well. We give thanks that the pandemic appears to be subsiding in this country, and for loving us and for never failing us. Holy Spirit, at times our thoughts wander and our actions do not honor you. We may have problems that we have not brought to you, or people that we are worried about. We may want to pray for the salvation of people we know. Whatever it is, in the next few moments, in the quiet of our hearts, we individually come to you, Lord, in prayer. Lord Jesus, we ask for healing for those who are sick and struggling with illnesses of any kind, including the COVID virus, or cancer, or addictions, or mental health challenges. Please be with all families that grieve. Draw us all together that we may support and help each other. Loving God, we trust our nation to your loving care. Give our leaders the wisdom to know what is right and the courage to do it. Give us your light and your truth to guide us in our ways so that we may seek your will in our lives and impact the world around us for your kingdom. Almighty God, while America is making progress with the pandemic, many other countries, particularly India, are being hit hard right now. Please heal the people in the countries where the pandemic is strong. Please comfort every soul as only you can. Bring hope to the hopeless and unity where there is conflict. Finally, please empower your church to spread the good news of the gospel to all nations. We ask all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Thank you very much.
So as I said before, we are starting this series and continuing look at the commands of God. I call them the words of life because God gave us these commands to fill our lives, not to make it more difficult. And some people have asked, well, have we done this before? And I have. This is the first sermon series that I did when I came to this church 11 and a half years ago, that we looked at the Ten Commandments. But, you know, it's redoing it, but looking at it once again. And I think it's always helpful to look at what God said kind of at the beginning of his forming the people of God. And as I said before, if you can, during the course of this series, to memorize, to help you live out these commands. And instead of trying to memorize them in total, I said, just summarize it, because this is what I do. No other gods, no idols. No misusing God's name. That's what we're looking at today. And honor the Sabbath. Honor your parents. And then the five don'ts. Don't murder. Don't commit adultery. Don't steal. Don't lie. Don't covet. So that's about, 27 words. And so take a crack at it. See if you can memorize it. The important thing is to kind of have that general idea, not the exact wording. So God bless you as you do this. And just a reminder, if you miss the other two messages on the first command, second command, they are posted online. Go ahead and take a look at them. But just as a reminder today, that command number one, you must not have any other gods but me. And the way that I summarized it was, it's all about putting God first. That's the first command. And the second command, you must not make for yourself an idol of any kind or an image of anything in the heavens, or on the earth or in the sea. And so we talked about not worshiping or trusting in any idol or any material thing, as in money, or to create a false image of God, that we have this image of who God is that we've created ourselves, not necessarily the God who is represented in the Bible. So those are the first two. And today we're looking at command number three. You must not misuse the name of the Lord your God. And so we're talking about names. And that reminded me of this guy, who's he? Shakespeare. And one of his famous quotes is, "What's in a name?" He said, "That which we call a rose, by any other name, would smell as sweet." I probably butchered the way he does. And I know this is not a rose, and it's fake anyway, but you get the point that, Shakespeare says, well, what's in a name? And so there's this other kind of humorous thing that there's this list of people whose names and occupations kind of go together. So Joe Bunt, what is he? That's right, a baseball player. Dan Druff. What is he? He is a barber. Jeff Treadwell. You might think tires, that's what I thought, but he's a podiatrist. Go forth and catch him. Of course, there are a couple of law enforcement guys, they're partners in law enforcement. And then O'Neill and Prey. And that's a church supply equipment company. So, sometimes names go together, sometimes they don't. We look at God, and I don't know if you've seen this before, maybe you have. It's called the Tetragrammaton, and it's four letters, and in Hebrew, it doesn't start here and go this way. It moves this way. So YHWH are the consonants, and there's no vowels in here. Vowels, if you've seen the Hebrew language, are represented by dots, but nothing is here. They've slimmed it down because the Jews considered God's name, this Tetragrammaton, so sacred that they never spoke the name of God, and they took out the vowels so that no one could even spell it or speak it. And so we actually don't know how this was pronounced because it's been lost in history. So some have said Jehovah, if you put in those consonants, or Yahweh, but no one knows for sure. But in some scriptures, if you read Jehovah or Yahweh, those are different ways of pronouncing those four letters, the name of God. And in the Bible, names are important. They reflect either reputation, character, or authority. So reputation, and we say that today, he's making a good name for himself, or someone who's always trouble. Oh, he has a bad name in town. So same thing in the Bible. And character, it's interesting that names go along with what was going on. So Isaac means laughter, or he laughs, because Sarah, his mom, named him that because she was laughing and people would laugh with her because she got pregnant in old age and had Isaac, and that was a gift from God, made her laugh. And Jacob was called the supplanter or the deceiver, and that showed through in his life that he actually was a deceiver. And Esau meant hairy, and yeah, he was a hairy guy. And Jesus, he was given the name Jesus because he will save the people from their sins. Jesus was a way of saying Joshua, which means rescuer, or someone to the rescue, and that was Jesus. And it's interesting, too, that as they look at names, that as people changed, their name changed. So Abram became Abraham. Abram meant father. Abraham meant father of many, and he became the father of the nation of Israel. And Jacob, the deceiver, became Israel. And Israel meant one who struggles or wrestles with God or confronts God. And so he became Israel. And of course, Simon became Peter, the rock, because Jesus said, I will build my church on this rock. And so his name was changed to Peter. So names were reflective of what was going on. And authority is something that we see a lot, especially connected with God's name. And Moses, when he was talking with God and given this mission of going and freeing people from Egypt, Moses says, suppose I go to the Israelites and I say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. They will ask me, well, what is his name? What should I tell them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. And so God calls himself the great I am. And so that represents his authority. So as we look at this commandment for ourselves, don't misuse God's name. What do you usually think of? You know, don't misuse God's name meant, no swearing. You know, don't use God or Jesus or Christ as a swear word. And sometimes, you know, people do that. And that is the obvious kind of interpretation or application of, you know, don't misuse God's name. So, and for those of us who may not say it, Jesus would say, don't even think of it. Don't even swear in your mind. So it's not even just speaking it out, but we need to be careful about how we use God's name. So thou shalt not cuss is another way of saying it, but this is just one way of dealing with this commandment. There are a lot more ways, a lot deeper meanings, other meanings to how we can apply this, how we can break this commandment. So some of you have heard in the King James Version, you must not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. And so you go, well, what does that mean? What's in vain? So you kind of have a general idea. But I like Adam Hamilton. He says it this way, that what this means is to use the name without reverence, to use it lightly or of no significance, or to use it carelessly. So it's not just as a swear word. It's really just diminishing the name of God or misusing God's name. And so what are ways that we can do that? How can we cross the barrier of right living to wrong? And so here are some different ways. First is don't use God's name as an excuse for your actions or to indulge in your own bad behavior. So what do I mean by that? If you say something like, well, God told me revenge was okay, or I prayed about it and I don't need to forgive that person, or God said it was okay to miss church. Now, when would God ever say that? It's okay to miss church. But or God said it's okay not to give any offering. That we take God's name and we use it in a way where we excuse our behavior or use it in a way to get what we want. And we kind of put that on God. And kind of related to this is don't use God's name to manipulate or to intimidate others. And you have probably experienced this or seen this, especially in church, where someone might say, well, God told me what you should do. Or God told me what you need to do, that you need to do this ministry. You need to be involved in this at church. Or it may even, well, God told me that I could do this, and this is what it means for you. Or you need to do this because it is God's will. So it's taking God's name and it's trying to move people around in a way that was never intended to be. And so I'm not saying that there aren't good counselors or that someone might say, you know, you might think of this, that this represents what I know of God. So it's not saying don't listen to other people or that other people can't give you counsel. But if someone says to you, well, God told me that you need to be doing this and doing it in a way that manipulates you or doesn't feel right, that you need to stay clear of those people. And so that's another way of breaking this command. Or we misuse God's name when we don't live the way that God intends us to live, that we become disobedient. We hear this in Isaiah. They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. So we can speak kindly or wonderfully or sound so spiritual with our words, but our actions, our hearts are far from God. They don't follow God or don't care about God. So our words and the things that we say don't match. And so God says this in the Old Testament. I hate all of your show and pretense, the hypocrisy of your solemn assemblies. I will not accept your offerings. Away with your noisy hymns of praise. I will not listen to the music of your harps. So he's talking about how, you know, the worship, the show, you're doing all this stuff, but it's just noisy things that I'm not listening to. What he says, instead, I want to see a mighty flood of justice, an endless river of righteous living. So God is saying, it's not just what we say about him, how we use his name. It's how do we live? What do we do with our lives? And so for us, we might say, well, Jesus is my Lord. And it's easy to say, and we might believe it, but really, is that the case? Is he the Lord of your time? Is he the Lord of your abilities? Is he the Lord of your money? It's easy just to say, oh, Jesus, you are my Lord. I love you, but I'm going to live the way I want to live. So we need to be clear about our words and how we think, and are we breaking this third command? And this is from Matthew. Jesus says, not everyone who calls out to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who actually do the will of my Father in heaven will enter. And this is an amazing verse. It's one of those Sunday school verses for me. It's like, wow, that got my attention because I thought, well, I'm going to church. I'm basically a good guy. And then these people were doing things in Jesus' name. And they would come to him and he says, away from me. I never knew you. That I didn't want to be that person, that guy. That I wanted to know the Lord and not just talk about him. And so that was a part of my transforming process. And so my question to you is, as you say, Jesus is your Lord, do you see transformation? Is your heart drawn to him? Where is your heart? Where is your attention? Because it's easy to say, I'm a Christian, I'm a follower of Christ, and he's my Lord. It's much harder to live that out. But as we live it out, we again, live within the spirit of that third commandment. So a part of this is we misuse God's name when we don't live as God would want us to live. And because of that, God is dishonored. So not only is it us that's impacted, but we dishonor God because of how we live, how we speak, what we do. Says this in Romans, you brag about having God's law, but you bring shame to God by breaking his law. And just as the scriptures say, those who are not Jews speak against God's name because of you. So Paul was telling the Jews of the time that even though you have the laws of God, you say you know God, that people are speaking against God, against his name because of what you do. So how do people see you? When they hear you, when they watch you, do they think good of you, think good of God, or as they look at your life, you're combative, you're mean, you're not generous, you may go to church, but they don't see any of the love or the kindness that's there. And so we dishonor God, or his name is dishonored, not only as you live, but it impacts how people see God as well. So we honor God's name when we live and love like Jesus, just as the Lord intended. So part of honoring his name is to live like Jesus. And so spend time in his word. You know, read the Gospels and see how Jesus interacted. And it's interesting. He was always on the side of the oppressed, those of the poor, the ones on the fringe. And he was most confronted with the church people, the religious people, the ones that thought they knew God. So it's always a reminder to me to be humble and to seek God and to make sure that I'm doing and living the way that God intended. And it's all about following Jesus, keeping your eyes on him. Because it's not about following political parties, not even following pastors, and certainly not the values of the world. It's about following Jesus. And so when people get wrapped up in politics or trying to hold up a certain church, a certain pastor, or following the things that are important in the world, that's where Christians can get off track, and that they can dishonor the name because they're actually not paying attention to Jesus. You may have seen this, you know, how's my driving? Because, you know, companies sometimes want accountability for the drivers, the people that are driving their trucks. I thought it'd be interesting. Well, how's my walk with Jesus? You know, call 800-GOD-LINE. That if people could say to God, hey, you know, I don't know about Garrett. He was doing this today. You know, it's a corrective. And how's my driving? You've heard me tell you about that before. It's risky when you put like a sticker on your car that identifies you as a Christian. And when I was younger, I wore a Jesus sticker, an ichthus that told people I was a Christian. And that was hard because it's like, it's right there. I'm a Christian. And so I always felt the burden or the awareness that what I would do, what I would say, would impact what people may think about Jesus. So how about you? You know, is that something that you are thinking of? And it says, whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So whatever you do, in word or in deed, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus. Do it in a way that would honor him, that reflects who Jesus is. And in that way, we fulfill this third command. So giving honor to God's name is kind of the positive way of saying, don't misuse his name. Don't take his name in vain. Because Jesus says, you are the light of the world. Let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. They see you, your actions, and they praise God. They lift him up. They lift up Jesus. It reminds me of a time when I was at the DMV. The picture sort of looks like me, but that's not me. But I had to go to the DMV. You're waiting a long time. My number is finally called after a little bit over an hour. And so I went up there, and the lady was so mean. You know, she looked at my papers, kind of slammed them down, goes, this is wrong. You did this wrong. You know, this is, you got to get out of here because you messed it up. It was like, wow, she really was not having a good day and she's making it hard on me. So in my head, as she's kind of lecturing me, I'm thinking, well, I could either respond with the same meanness or with some sort of confrontation. But I thought, well, that's not going to help her, not going to help me. It's not a representative of what I believe. So I just thanked her for helping me, for, you know, making it clear, ask her what I should do next. And I thanked her for being there and for her work. And I said, and there was no sarcasm in it. I really did want to convey to her that I was thankful for the work that she did. And I'd love to tell you, oh yeah, we became best friends and she started going to church. Did it make a difference? Well, I don't really think so. But the point isn't that I did it so that she would change. I did it because it would be what Jesus would do. And it reflects what I believe about Jesus and how he interacts with people. So when we are doing these things, it's not about what we get. It's really just about Jesus and honoring him. There's a story of a guy who went to a pizza place in a tough part of Kansas City. And as he went to pick up his pizza, there were kids outside lined up, and it was getting close to dinner, so it's kind of getting dark. And so when he got his pizza, he asked the owner, well, what's going on? He goes, well, there are some kids in this neighborhood that don't really get a full meal. So about this time, if they're hungry and they didn't get a meal, they can come and have a slice of pizza. And so I give them out. And he said it without any kind of remorse, and actually looked at the kids. He goes, isn't God great? And the biggest smile, and it was like he was so proud and so full of wonder that he could do this, just some kind action in the name of God. And he wasn't going to get anything in return, but he did what he could. And I think that's what Mother Teresa, why she is so intriguing and honored among people, that she would sacrifice and give her love in a way that represented how Jesus might do it. So as you go through your day, instead of being negative or hurtful or reflecting some of the hostility or the conflict or the tension in our world, when it comes your way, return kindness, return generosity, and turn the other cheek. So we reflect the love of Jesus, who just wants to embrace people, especially people who are hurt or people in need, or maybe difficult people, the ones that we don't want to love. That's who Jesus wants to get to. And we honor his name by doing that. If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross, and follow me. And it's not a hard thing. Your life will be changed in ways that are wonderful and amazing. So again, remember, so I said no other gods, no idols, but maybe another way of remembering, honor God's name. Honor the Sabbath, honor your parents, don't commit murder, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't lie, don't covet. So we'll go through these. If you want to comment, if there's things that were helpful to you, I'd love to hear that. If you have any questions or ideas about the other commands that are coming up, you know, send me a note or make a comment. But understand that these commands are not about making life difficult. It's to show love. It says, greater love has no one than this, that he lays down his life for his friends. And that's what Jesus did for us. And I want to remind you that today we have a communion service. It's on a separate posting. And so we hope that you'll join us for that. And it's a way of, again, being reminded of the love of God, and that you and I are changed by that love. And as we live out these words of God, these Ten Commands, that life opens up. And we embrace it in a way that we couldn't before. So may God bless you as you honor his name this week. Thank you. So glad you could be with us today. And if you appreciated or were helped by this message, we hope you'll like, subscribe, share, and yeah, leave your comments. If there's anything that you'd like to know or have me talk about, I'd like to know that. And also for your giving, we appreciate anything that you are able to give. And I want to thank those of you who have been faithful in giving this past year to help us stay strong. But as you give, you impact how we can love our world. And so we thank you for that. And if you've missed any of the past messages, like I said, you can go to other postings that are still there and to join us for communion. That's also on a separate posting. So hope to see you next week. Now hear this benediction. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you, and may he make his face to shine upon you, and may you know the love of God, the grace of Christ, and the power of the Spirit each and every day. God bless you. See you next week. Them doggies rolling.
Okay, quiet on the set.
Quiet.
Intro.
On the set.
Worship on May 2nd. Take one.
I couldn't understand anything you just said.
New lights. That's because your mouth was open. It's really hard to hear when your mouth is talking.
Whoa.
That's what my mother used to tell me. Anyway, okay, once again, worship May 2nd. Intro. Take one.
That's three, four. Can you make me crack up?
Loosen up.
I know, yeah. Now where am I? What?